Hello, I'm Kirsty Young, and this is a podcast from the Desert Island Discs archive. For rights reasons, we've had to shorten the music. The programme was originally broadcast in 1997, and the presenter was Sue Lawley.
My castaway this week is a comedian. Brought up in a middle-class family, he went to a Catholic public school but managed to unearth enough rebellious spirit to become a weekend punk. At university, he and his friends took a show to the Edinburgh Fringe and, as a result, moved into the London cabaret circuit and appearances on radio and television. It was his talent which ultimately prevented him from getting what he would call a proper job. His characters, Stavros, Tim Nice But Dim, Kevin the Teenager, and perhaps most famously, Loads of Money, have made an indelible mark on British entertainment and made their creator, at 35, one of its leading stars. He is Harry Enfield. One of its leading stars and one who appeals to people across the board, Harry. I mean, you have entered the realms of family entertainment, haven't you?
I suppose I have, although I'm a bit ruder than I should be, really, for family entertainment.
When are you rude?
Well, I'm always on at 9:30, and I think I shouldn't have to be on at 9:30. And my father always pointed out to me, well, we watched it, but we had to turn the sound down.
I suppose, if you think about it, Frank Doberman of the Oi, No character, he was pretty nasty about Camilla Parker Bowles in this last series, wasn't he? I mean, pretty rough stuff for you, really.
Yes, he was foul, and actually I think I thought of the joke in the first place. The thing about him is he only works with certain names, and Parker Bowles happened to be one of those names, that you always talk about her as Camilla Parker Bowles. No one calls her Parker Bowles. But he does. He says, you know, if Parker Bowles come into my house...
He was pretty rough on Anthea Turner as well, actually, wasn't he?
Rough on Anthea Turner. He's a nasty man, yeah.
Are there any of your characters you really don't like?
I don't particularly like him. I mean, I feel sorry for all my characters because I know why they are like they are.
You don't like Tory Boy, do you?
Well, I feel quite sorry for Tory Boy because... At 13, he should be interested in girls and things like that, but he's only interested in Tory politics, bless him, politics. And he's very like me. I was a sort of socialist at that age, but the same. I was obsessed by politics and I wasn't particularly interested in anything else.
And did you bore the family at the breakfast table?
Oh, yes. I used to have rows with my father. He would say, what about this? And I'd say, under a socialist government, this won't happen. And he'd get so enraged, he used to have to go into the garden halfway through lunch and pick sprouts or do whatever.
And did you have horrible spots like Tory Boy as well?
I didn't have spots, no. I've always had a very lovely face.
But aren't you more like Kevin the Teenager, who's sort of endlessly horrible to his parents, and his parents are endlessly really very nice to him?
Yes, I was. I've been sent lots of letters about Kevin from parents saying, thank you very much, this has been very therapeutic. We thought we were the only people in the country who had a teenager like this.
It's true.
Just, you know, it only occurred to me about 2 years ago. I was thinking about my poor father coming to pick me up from parties at 1 o'clock. He'd have to wait outside. He would not be allowed to come and ring the doorbell because I didn't want my friends to see this sad man. I bitterly resented him even existing, you know, but I wouldn't have been able to go to the party or come home without him.
And did you metamorphose overnight into this incredibly communicative and helpful son the day or the night after, the morning after you lost your virginity?
No, I don't think I did. I think that was an exaggeration. That was in the last programme. This is what I mean about a family show, you see. We have virginity losing and things like that, innit?
Tell me about your first record.
Oh, well, my first record is by the Beatles. It's the first record I was ever given, which my Aunt Faye gave me, an EP when I was about 4. And it was rebellion
from A Hard Day's Night. Tell me about your family background then, Harry. Very neat and tidy home counties conservatives, were they?
Oh, well, they were neat and tidy, or Mum was. Certainly she was. She keeps a neat and tidy house. Not conservative, I don't...
What did your dad do for a living?
He was a local government officer. He worked for the Education Department in West Sussex. I mean, we lived in a conservative area, but my pa's always been a rebel. I mean, his mother was very Labour, very firmly Labour. In fact, I don't think she stood for Parliament, but she certainly was part of the Whisper Green Labour Party, her and the local...
Was she the one who knew Virginia Woolf? Or...
Oh, yes, yes. Virginia and Leonard Woolf published a book by my grandmother, but they didn't like them, and I don't know why they didn't like them, but...
Who, the Woolfs didn't like the Enfields?
Mm, yes, or Virginia loathed my parents. I don't know why, but there was... I was looking for a book to give my father for Christmas one year, and I saw a copy of part of Virginia Woolf's diaries, and I looked up in the glossary in the back, Enfield, and found it, and thought, oh, good. Let's see if there's a reference to my parents there, and I looked it up, and it was something like... I phoned up Lytton Straight Sheep, but he wasn't there. He'd gone to tea with the Enfields. I'd rather be dead in a field than go to tea with the Enfields. So I didn't give it to my dad. But
but he's heard about it since.
Yes. Anyway, I don't know what she had against him, the lousy cow.
Tell me about Billingshurst, which is where the family lived when you were little. You got a Saturday job in Barker's, the electrical shop in the High Street.
Oh, I did. I did when I was sort of, 16, 17. I always had Saturday jobs.
And this is where you learned to act because you told lies on the phone, I read.
Oh, I told lies all the time. It was only Saturdays, and these irate old women would come in all the time on the Saturday and say, where's my iron? You said it would be ready by today. And I'd go out the back, and there would be their iron there that hadn't been mended, and it was just left in the back. And I'd have to whisper to someone, and they'd go, tell them to go away. And I said, I'm terribly sorry, it needs a new gubbins, and the gubbins doesn't come in until next Wednesday, and send them away again.
So you learned about posh old ladies, and then you had a milk round, or you were a milkman or something, and learned about the aspirational middle classes, is that right?
Oh, yes. My round was started with council houses and then went to the sort of new detached, semi-detached houses, then out into the country. And it was interesting, the reaction you got. In the council houses, everyone was lovely to you. And then they were a bit more standoffish in the new semi-detached houses. But they'd still leave notes out saying, please. In the big exclusive estates, people would leave orders for you. These horrid new mock Georgian places. Just say, milkman, 2 pints extra. And I just used to write, please, at the bottom and not leave the milk.
But you didn't realise during all this time that you were doing incredibly valuable research. I mean, somehow you stored it away, obviously.
I did store it. I mean, I suppose one stores everything over life, doesn't one?
Record number two.
Ooh, well, record number two is the overture to Nabucco by Giuseppe Verdi. And I thought, well, if I can't have the whole opera, if I've got this, then I can hum the rest to myself for the rest of the day.
Part of the overture to Verdi's Nabucco, played by the Vienna Opera Orchestra, conducted by Lamberto Gardelli. You did a series, Harry Enfield, for Channel 4 about opera. Do you genuinely like it, or were you just trying
your
hand?
I do. I love it. But I don't know much about it, so that's why I did a series. It was a sort of beginner's guide.
There is part of you, isn't there, that's a kind of mission to explain, as it were. You quite like all of that.
I'm a bit of a schoolmaster, yeah.
Would you like to develop that? I mean, would you like to explain the effects of the minimum wage to the nation?
Yes, I would. I'd like to explain where people's pensions go or things like that. You know, I mean, I'd like to understand, and I wish other people could understand. I'd like to understand why people can't talk to each other in Northern Ireland or, you know, lots of things like that. Yes, I'm much more interested in all that than comedy. Really.
So are you saying that you'd like to do it with a comic bent, as it were, or whether you'd like to be a factual presenter?
I'd love to be a factual presenter, you know, but unfortunately I fell into comedy first.
So you're trapped, are you?
I feel a bit trapped at the moment, yeah, but I'm sure I'll get out of it.
Because you read politics at university.
I did, yes.
So you feel strongly politically?
I went to university, age 18, thinking I'd almost sorted out how to run the world. There were just one or two fine points I needed to clear up. And I came out 3 years later thinking there are millions of fine points. Millions of points. I'm in a hopeless mess about the whole thing, which was good. And the more I learn and the more I read, the more of a mess I feel in, which is why I find it interesting, I think.
But you didn't hitch your wagon at this last election to any particular political party, did you?
No, I'm a member of a political party, but I didn't go around the country. Yes, but I didn't go around the country with them or anything.
You resisted. You were asked, weren't you?
Well, I was approached by the Tony Blair's office, but I said to them that the newspapers had pictures of my bare bottom, which they took on my honeymoon.
You thought it was better for him if you stayed away?
Yes.
Well,
much
as it turns out, it was.
It
really
was. Look, it was a landslide.
Record number three.
Oh, record number three is White Man in the Hammersmith Palais by The Clash when I was 16. 15, I went from Worth, the lovely public school, to the grammar school, Colliers in Horsham, and met Ted and Dave and all these people who are still my friends now. And we became punks, and it was just fantastic, and I developed a Mockney accent. And we went up to London, and went, all right, Paul, all right, Nick, and we could meet these groups. And they couldn't play very well, but you could meet them, and it didn't matter.
Clash and White Man in the Hammersmith Palais. What did your parents think, though, at the time when you were going up to London with your Mockney accent?
Oh, they just thought I was ghastly. You know, I'd come home and I had sort of black spiky hair. I didn't wear my sort of punkiest clothes around the house. I used to hide them because I couldn't bear the look on Mum's face. I think they treated me rather like their best friend's horrible dog that had to come and stay with them for 2 weeks and, you know, wasn't house-trained. You know, Dad worked terribly hard and Mum worked very hard to make sure that we were all lawyers and doctors and, you know, nice West Sussex people, and none of us have turned out that way.
So you...
And I was the worst, really.
You've wasted a good education, have you?
Hopeless, yeah.
You've won them over now, I'm sure.
Won them over in the end, yes, but that's because I'm writing for the Sunday Telegraph. So.
Is it true that you got a grant from the Manpower Services Commission to set up as a cabaret performer?
Well, yes, I did. This was when I left university with my friend Brian Elsley, and we started doing a cabaret act, and we were on the dole for about 6 months, I suppose. But then if we did a cabaret act, we'd get sort of £20 and we'd have to declare £10 of it. And it all got rather complicated. And the Manpower Services, quite rightly, I mean, it was a good idea, really. They said, well, we'll give you £40 to be a new business and then whatever money you keep, and we'd just tax the whole thing. So that's all it was, really. It was a way of, you know, manipulating the dole figures.
But that was after you'd failed, I think, as a writer for Weekending on Radio 4, hadn't you?
Oh, hopeless. We came down from Edinburgh in 1982 and we tried to write for it and didn't get anything on. And it was quite good because about 3 years later, I heard from John Lloyd, who produced Weekending many years before, that he hadn't been able to get anything on it when he tried to write for it, nor had Douglas Adams, who did Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy.
So you were in good company.
We were in quite good company, yeah.
record number four?
Oh, record number four is Blackberry Way by The Move. Something that reminds me of my childhood and having a dog. It was just after Lucy, my littlest sister, was born, so I think I was quite happy. There she was.
Goodbye, Blackberry Way.
Move and Blackberry Way. At what point in all of this, Harry, did you meet your friend and collaborator Paul Whitehouse, who, for anyone who doesn't know, is the other chap in the dinner jacket who takes a bow at the top and the bottom of your programme and does a wonderful impersonation of Michael Caine and a Peruvian Geordie footballer as well?
He does, Julio Giordio.
Yeah, he's great.
Well, I first met Paul in 1980, I think. I knew of him. I knew his girlfriend of the time, Mary, terribly well. And I needed somewhere to stay. I was being a milkman in Finsbury Park in my university holidays, and I needed somewhere to stay, and they lived in Hackney. And I went and knocked on the door and said, can I stay? And he said, yeah, come in. And was lovely and looked after me for about 8 weeks. And then when I started doing television, he was being a plasterer at the time. He'd worked for Hackney Council before that. And I said, will you write for me? And he, nah. And then in 1987, he finally did.
Did he know he could write?
No, he didn't.
You didn't know he could write? But you could tell from
the
way he talked.
Well, I knew he was funnier than anyone else I knew.
Is it true he created Stavros or Loads of Money?
Oh, yeah, I mean, both, really. See, I don't know if Paul would agree with this, but I remember exactly how it started. I remember being on Highbury and Islington Station waiting for a train, and there was a bit of copper pipe on the other side with rubber on it that we just saw over the thing, and I just said to Paul, you see that pipe over there, you could melt that down, there's money in that or something, you take the rubber off, bosh. And Paul went off on a huge thing of, that's right, in your furnace, bonk, in there, dosh, copper, there's money in copper. And by the time the train came, which was about 5 minutes later, he'd melted down the whole station. Then he was melting down the train. And then on the train, he was melting down the factories we passed on the way. And it was all, you could melt that down, there's money in that. And literally for the next 3 months, he carried on melting everything down.
And making loads of
and
money.
And saying there's money in that, loads of money in that. And I wrote the show I did with Loads of Money in it in 1987 with Paul.
So now you're a team. Mm. You've done quite a few shows together, but there are often, you know, big gaps between them. Why does it take so long?
Partly because I had a sort of rough time in my personal life between the third show and the fourth show. So I wasn't really in the mood for comedy. And then partly because it just takes a long time to come up with things that I think are different, and I don't like carrying on doing exactly the same thing.
And am I right in thinking that you don't enjoy doing them very much?
I find it very hard work, but I do get terribly wound up, and I'm a real gloom when I'm doing it. And Paul comes in and says, how's Grumpy today? And, you know, Paul's the life and soul of the party when we're making it, and I'm the grumpy one.
And is there never?
And Kathy's the lovey who won't shut up telling anecdotes.
Is there never any joy in it for you, though? Do you know? Or not until it's over, and you think, yeah, thank God for that.
Yeah, it's the thing I like best is editing, because I can wear my own clothes. I don't have to wear makeup. And, you know, a couple of years ago, I was putting on old ladies' clothes, all this makeup. And I thought, what am I doing? You know, I'm 34.
What should a 34-year-old be doing?
He should be in the Welsh office or something, shouldn't he?
Record number five.
Ah, this is the Soldiers' Chorus from Il Trovatore, also by Verdi. I chose this because I used it as the inspiration to my first series, so it'll remind me of working and thinking, thank goodness I don't have to go on television anymore. Now I'm on a desert island.
Thank you.
part of the soldiers' chorus from Act 3 of Verdi's Il Trovatore, with the new Philharmonia Orchestra conducted by Zubin Mehta. You've been much applauded, Harry, in the trade for killing off characters. Loads of Money is a very good example. When they're in their prime, do you decide they've run their course, or do you just like to be ahead of the game?
Yes, I mean, Loads of Money, I got lots of praise, especially from The Guardian and things, saying, oh, he's killed him just at the right time, you know, the recession's coming and all this, he's so brave. And he realised that people were taking him too seriously, you know, and people were taking it seriously, this character, and they were being like Loads of Money. And I killed him because he was two-dimensional, and we'd done 10 three-minute sketches. That was all.
There's no more left in him.
No, he was too-dimensional.
Am I right in saying that this last series was the first time you featured gays in your show? Because there were the camp jockeys.
Yes.
And...
I think so, yes. I like to have a little bit of everything, really.
But I suppose the most poignant sketch of all last time was the family, the sort of disgusted Tunbridge Wells family, I suppose it was, in which the butt of the joke is the middle-aged father who can't cope with the idea of his son being gay, and the son brings his gay lover home for Sunday lunch. There's a great sadness in that sketch as well.
There was. It really appealed to me. That actually, the idea came from Richard Preddy and Gary Howe, who said, we've got this desperately trying to be modern dad. And I thought, this is my father. This is just brilliant. And I just did it exactly like my father. Don't understand the modern world. You've got a son. You love him very much. He comes round with his home with his lover, who happens to be a man. And you know, you've been brought up in a different generation where poofters are Nancy boys. And you've got to pretend that this is normal because... it is sort of normal in the modern world, and you're just not very good at it. And everybody was very sympathetic, and you felt sorry for all of them, so you didn't feel it was gay bashing, which it wasn't supposed to be. It was supposed to be affectionate, but looking at people who couldn't quite cope.
Record number 6.
This is a beautiful French song which was introduced to me by my dear friend Kate St. John, who does the music for my shows, and it reminds me of many happy times I've had over the years with Kate and all my friends.
Parlez-moi d'amour, redites-moi des choses tendres. Votre beau discours, mon cœur n'est pas là de l'entendre. Pourvu que
Parlez-moi d'amour by Lucien Boyer, and that was recorded in 1930. You got married, Harry, to Lucy. You married her in February and you're pregnant.
I'm not pregnant, but
well,
Lucy is.
Together you're pregnant.
Oh, I see.
And you had a ritzy wedding and you took this sun photographer on honeymoon with you, which was a bit rash.
Yes. Fame,
does it worry you? I sense you don't like it very much.
Well, it hasn't bothered me that much, being famous. But in London, you see, most people just say, hello, Harry, and I go, hello, and it's like, you know, that used to happen to me in Billingshurst.
That's familiar and friendly.
People wouldn't know who you are. So it's just I don't know who they are.
But there must be those moments when, you know, you're enjoying your privacy or the countryside or whatever, and somebody yells out one of your catchphrases, like, I didn't ought to do it like that.
Oh, that happens all the time. You don't want to do it like that. And I have to go, you know. The worst of the Kevins, though, the youths who follow you at 20, 25 yards and then shout your name, hey, Enfield! And then you turn round and they're all looking at the pavement because they're too scared to actually look at you. And they'll follow you for miles.
And now you're going to make a film, I read. You're going to make one called The Devil and the Seven Deadly Sins, in which you play all 8 characters. How much input do you get then into that? Because presumably if you're going to represent gluttony or sloth or greed or whatever, it's got to come from you, hasn't it?
Oh, yes, it has. I'm working very closely with Will Osborne, who's writing it. And I've never had a writer who's written everything. You know, I've never done anything that I haven't co-written. And I just can't do it. I can read other people's words and I can't see how to do it at all. I really have to work closely with them to get the character and then get them to write the words.
But you keep coming back to this. There's obviously a real desire, if not need, in you to become more serious in some way, is there?
Well, I think so. I'm 35 and
I keep saying that.
Yeah, I don't want to still be doing this when I'm 50.
Well, Dick Emery did.
I know, but I don't want to be Dick Emery. I don't want to be a grey-haired, you know, chirpy comedian.
What chubby, do you want to be, then?
Chirpy. I wouldn't mind being in production or directing or something, but I'd sooner be behind the camera. I especially don't want children to grow up, my children, with this little one we've got on the way, to grow up with a famous dad. I don't think it helps.
It's too late now, though, isn't it?
Hmm?
It's too late now.
Or, well, I might
or
not
they'll
be
point
famous
at you in the street
then.
And say, didn't you used to be?
Yes. You know? Weren't you once Harry Enfield? What happened to you? I got a kiss from Beryl Bainbridge the other day. She came up and she said, and I love Beryl Bainbridge. I really admire her as an author. She came up, gave me a huge kiss and said, that's not for you, it's for your father. Now imagine the twitch of rage and jealousy. That
Why? I don't understand that at all.
Frightful. That this woman, you know, my father was an ordinary person. He was a local government officer, and now here he is doing things on Watchdog.
You're jealous?
Madly jealous, yes. Madly jealous. And I commiserate with Dominic Lawson, the editor of the Sunday Telegraph, because his father used to be an ordinary Chancellor of the Exchequer. And now he writes diet books and appears on daytime telly, and he hates it too. It's embarrassing having your parents acting in this way.
Record number 7.
Number 7 is Born for a Purpose by Dr. Alamantade, which I first heard when I was about 16 and I went up to stay with Dave Cummings, who now writes for me, who was a friend from school, in Norwich at university. And there was a very frightening chap there called Switch. He was so cool, he didn't speak to me all weekend. I was enormously impressed. I remember him putting on this record in the evening and everyone sitting around rocking gently to it.
If you feel like you have no reason for living,
for a Purpose by Dr. Alimantado. So tell me about Harry Enfield on a desert island. I mean, are you going to go into one of these awful glooms of yours?
I think so, yes. I think I'll go into big gloom. I like having people around. I like being on my own for a bit, but not for too long.
Mm.
And the idea of never getting off this thing would drive me mad, I think.
Well, you could sit there and work out, you know, the implications of the single currency and yes, the minimum wage and all
this. I could, but it wouldn't do much good because I couldn't tell anyone else, could I? The important thing is you can say, oh, I've worked it out, and then they can say, no, you haven't thought of this, and you go, ooh, I'll go away again.
But would it be an occasion for serious thought, do you think? I mean, would the serious side of Harry Enfield then emerge?
I think the depressed side of Harry Enfield would emerge. I think I wouldn't like it. I don't like the heat.
Well, you can go to a cold one. You can go to a deserted island.
Oh.
You can go to a Hebridean island. Do you want to go to a hot one or a cold one, really?
Sort of mid-temperature one, please. 164 Fahrenheit.
You're obviously just like your dad, aren't you? That's
yes,
what you are.
I know.
Harry
my
Enfield
mother says
is his
that.
Father.
Mm, I know.
Hmm?
Pathetic, really. Like father, like son.
Last record.
The last record is Nulla in Mundo Pax in Sera by Vivaldi, which we had at our wedding, and it reminds me of my lovely wife and my lovely wedding and signing things and looking at each other.
Thank you.
part of Vivaldi's cantata Nulla in Mundo Pax Sincera, sung by Emma Kirkby with the Academy of Ancient Music, conducted by Simon Preston. So which one of those eight, Harry, if you could only take one of them, which one would it be?
I sort of feel I ought to have the last one, but then maybe I'd miss Lucy so much.
Don't you make
you
cry?
That I'd top myself even quicker, so maybe I'll go for Nabucco, because that's uplifting, really uplifting.
Right.
And I think I'll need a bit of uplifting.
What about your book?
Well, I chose before I came, I thought about it, and I thought, I want the collected writings of Karl Marx, and I'd really like to study it properly, but I'd get terribly bored. So maybe I'll take Bleak House, because I love Bleak House. I'll take that instead.
Right. And what about this luxury?
I'd like... I think I'd like a beer and fag machine. And then I can at least on this desert island... Am I allowed paper and pens as
no,
well?
No, no, no,
no.
No? Beer and fags only. Or, either or.
Oh. Beer and fag and paper and pen machine?
No.
It's one machine.
Beer and fag machine is stretching it far enough, really.
I'd hate to have a beer and fag machine and no coins to go in it.
No, well, it, really it works. It works. You don't need coins. Beer and fag machine, is it?
No, it's paper and pen, then. Beer and fag machine, go on. I've got nothing to write.
Harry Enfield, thank you very much indeed for letting us hear your Desert Island Discs.
Thank you.
You've been listening to a podcast from the Desert Island Discs archive. For more podcasts, please visit bbc.co.uk/radio4.